Ready? So, good evening, everybody. The setup today is going to give me dizzy, switching from side to side, so I apologize for not looking at you constantly. I'll look at you. My name is Alon Anava. In Bezat Hashem tonight, I'm going to share with you my personal story, how I became religious 15 years ago, after I had what's called a near-death experience. 15 years ago, one day, out of the blue, my heart stopped. You're going to hear the story. For about 7 minutes, I was not alive. My neshama left my body, went up to the heavens, made a tour, and came back. Now, the story is very, very long. So I get right to the point with a very short introduction that I grew up in Israel, and I grew up the most non-religious you can imagine. That's how I grew up. And I grew up hating religion, hating God, hating anything that had to do with this. And you know, in our Torah, there's a concept that is called Hidu Mitzvah, when you have an opportunity to do a mitzvah, and you make it even more beautiful than you're supposed to. This is called Lehader B'Mitzvah. So I was Mehader B'Averot. If I would have the opportunity to do a sin, I would make sure that I'm doing it with all the right ways, that the pork is the very not kosher, and the best way to do the Averah, that's how I would do it. And it might sound funny, but it's not so funny. Better. The point is just to understand how not religious I was. And some of you, I see you got the black card. You can look at the picture, that's the before picture. They say a picture is worth 1,000 words, and this picture is worth 100,000 words. Just my mom is my organizer. She chose a nice picture. Once I used to go with not nice pictures. She used to be like, why are you taking such horrible pictures of you? So this is a normal picture. The point to take from that I was very not religious. And I did everything I could to despise the Torah. Some people, they're not religious, but they don't care. They don't do anything. Some people, they go the extra mile to make sure that they're mocking the Kadosh Baruch Hu and making fun of the Torah. And unfortunately, that's how I grew up. And when I was 23, I left Israel. I came to the United States. I came here to New York. And the whole story happened on a very special day. First of all, it was a Saturday. It was Shabbat. But more than that, it was the 14th day of Nisan, which is the morning of Pesach. It's the morning where you burn the chametz, when everybody goes crazy, when everybody's freaking out a minute before Pesach. That's when it happened. Now, why is it so special? Because when I was a little kid and they told me about Pesach, they told me, listen, 3,000 years ago, the Jews were in Mitzrayim, and they were slaves, and they were carrying bricks and building pyramids. And then came this guy with a very long beard. His name was Moishele. And he did some hocus pocus, and he got everybody out. And since then, we eat matzahs. But don't really believe in it, because it's not true. It's a fairy tale. And the proof we have that it's a fairy tale is, look at the book that we read. It's called Haggadah. Haggadah, with the letter He, is when you tell a story. But Haggadah, with an Aleph, is a fairy tale in Hebrew. So they told me, don't believe in it because it's a fairy tale. So that's how I grew up. But really, why did we celebrate the day? Not because something happened 3,300 years ago. Because on that specific day came down to this world a very godly light, a very special godly light, that allowed the Jews at the time to break out of their limitation. You know, the story says that they were in Egypt. Egypt in Hebrew is Mitzrayim. Mitzrayim comes from the word in Hebrew, Meitzar. Meitzar is something that limits you, a limitation. So they were able to leave Mitzrayim, to leave their limitation, and to break out to spiritual freedom. And that day permeated the power for the rest of the generation that any Jew that needs to break out of their Mitzrayim, out of their limitation, has the power to break out of it and to go into spiritual freedom. And that's the day that it happened. Now, the story is very, very long. I'm going to get straight to the point with one special request. Please do not ask questions as I go, because there's a big crowd, and if you're going to ask questions now, we're going to finish at 2 a.m. and some people want to go to sleep early. Besides the fact that probably half your questions are going to be answered as I speak. Later on, whatever you want to ask questions, we'll stay here. They told me Shacharit is at 5:15, so we have enough time to answer questions. The most important thing to remember and to understand is that I'm going to share mainly the experience itself. But it's almost impossible to explain it. Because everything that I remember like it is if it happened this morning. It's engraved in my memory so strong that I don't need to review the information. The only problem is that it's almost impossible to explain it. Because everything that I saw does not exist in this world. So I have to use my words. It's as difficult to explain to a blind person that was born blind and never saw anything how the color blue looks. So you will tell that person, okay, blue, the sky is blue. Yeah, but I never saw the sky. Okay, the ocean is blue. Yeah, but I never saw the ocean. Now, it doesn't matter how you're going to try to relate and explain the color, he never saw anything. He can't understand what you're saying even. This is almost as difficult as that. To try to explain something that you never saw and to put it into words. So it's very important that you don't take every word that I say and like get fixed on it and say, oh, that's how it is. You have to kind of go with the flow. Now the whole story starts here in New York, Friday night, Erev Shabbat, Erev Pesach. It was right before the day of Pesach, so we went to a party. We called it a Pesach party. You can see by the picture what type of a party. We didn't really play bingo in that party. And towards the end of the night, a friend from the bunch of friends that we were together, passes around this device, this smoking thing, device that you smoke drugs with. And I really didn't know what's in it. And I started feeling very, very sick. But not sick that I have to throw up, or that I'm dizzy, or that I have to faint. I literally felt I'm about to die. Now there was a girl with me in the party. I told her, we gotta leave the building. I think I'm about to explode. We leave the building. It was somewhere in Manhattan, in the West Side. I felt so bad that all I wanted to do is to go home. We stop a cab, I go into the cab, I sit in the back seat of the car. And there's really no words to describe how I felt, but that I knew I'm about to die. Now, a lot of people ask me, what do you mean you knew? How do you know you're about to die? How do you know such a thing? So, first of all, we know, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai explains in the Zohar, that 40 days before a person dies, they announce in the heavens, this person is about to die. 30 days before the person is about to die, every day a piece of the tzelem, we have a component in our neshama that is called tzelem. This is a godly figure. This is an external part of the neshama. It doesn't penetrate into the body. Every day one piece leaves. The morning of the death, the neshama leaves the body. A couple minutes before the person dies, the ruach leaves the body, a different component of the neshama. And then seconds before the person dies, the nefesh is very vulnerable because the neshama and the ruach left the body. The nefesh goes into the heart and closes itself, and then the person dies. So that's mystically what happens, how a person knows he's about to die. That's why you see many people before they die, they start saying goodbye to people, they give things away, they start saying all sorts of weird things. But really, when people ask me, how did you know you're about to die, is because when you experience something, you know what you're experiencing. If you're hungry, you know you're hungry. If you have a headache, you know you have a headache. You don't need somebody to come and tell you, you have a headache. And nobody can come and tell you, you don't look like you have a headache, you look fine. If you feel something and you experience something, you know what you're going through. If you're happy, you know you're happy. You're sad, you know you're sad. You know it. This is what's called in Lashon Kodesh, Yediyah. I know. You wake up in the morning, you know who you are. You know where you live. So I knew I'm about to die. It was just obvious. And I'm sitting in the back seat of the car, scared out of my mind, and I'm starting to choke. So I open up the window, thinking maybe some fresh air will make a difference. And I look out the window and suddenly the whole world froze. Like a picture. Like you're looking at a TV, and you click the pause button, and the movie stops, the world froze. Nothing moved. And everywhere that I look, frozen. And my mind is racing 5,000 miles an hour, and all that I can think of is that I'm about to leave this world. I know I'm about to leave this world. And I'm about to meet this famous God that everybody was talking about. And now I have a serious problem, because I'm coming with nothing. I have nothing. Now at that point in my life, physically, I had anything a person would want. I had a very, very big and successful company. I had millions of dollars. Gorgeous car, beautiful home. Anything that you would wish for yourself, that times 1,000 I had. For 3 years I traveled all over the world. I did whatever you could think of. And it was the first time in my life that I realized that everything that I have in this world is worthless. The car is going to stay parked in the driveway. The money is going to stay in the bank. And that's it. And the only thing that I can take with me, I don't have. I don't even have one mitzvah. Not even one mitzvah. And I know that I'm coming empty-handed. Now I'm going to have to stand in front of this famous God and say, why don't I have even a mitzvah? There's no words to describe the fear, because there's no such fear in this world to say, oh, I was afraid like that. And it literally felt like 20 minutes that nothing is moving, the world is frozen, and all that's going on in my mind is what I did in my life. And I felt this unbelievable remorse, unbelievable feeling of regret. Of what did I do? Why did I do that? Why did I have to steal this? Why did I have to cheat here? Why did I have to curse there? No words to describe this remorse, this regret that I messed up my life. And the feeling was so extreme that I only found one way to kind of explain how it felt. Imagine now a person wants to kill himself. Goes and chooses the biggest building in Manhattan, climbs on the roof, takes a look down, takes a deep breath, jumps. Now imagine what's going on in that person's mind the second his feet leave the ground. What did I do? I just killed myself. Now I can't jump back, and I have about a minute before I hit the ground. That's how I felt. What did I do? I just wasted 27 years of my life. Now I can reverse my life, and I have about a minute before I'm out. Now what? Now there's a concept in our Torah that is called tshuva. Tshuva means to repent. Means to do tshuva. I did something bad. I go and say I'm sorry. I give back what I stole. There's a whole process in the tshuva. It's not so simple. But there's a concept that a person, chas v'shalom, sinned, went away from the Torah, and he does a U-turn and comes back and does tshuva. And the Kadosh Baruch Hu accepts all the balei tshuva. The only problem is that to do tshuva, it's a process. It's not an overnight thing. You have to do a lot of actions, you have to start doing mitzvot, you have to fix all the problems you did in the past. But there's also a concept in our religion that is called hirhur tshuva. Hirhur tshuva meaning is to think of tshuva. For example, you said something wrong to somebody, you hurt that person's feelings, you go home and you're like, hey, why did I say that? I shouldn't have said that. Tomorrow I'm going to call and apologize. You think in your mind, okay, I shouldn't have done that. Now, some of the sins that a person can do in this world are so severe that our sages teach us that he loses his place in the world to come. Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai says in the Zohar, if a person did a second before he leaves this world, he did hirur tshuva. He thought about tshuva. Yesh lo chelek l'olam haba. He has a place in the world to come. So I was sitting in the back seat of the car doing tshuva, thinking in my mind, why did I have to steal that? Why did I have to cheat here? Why did I have to curse that person? Why did I have to do this? I shouldn't have done that. Why I couldn't do this? And for 20 minutes, I'm doing an account in my mind. Scared out of my mind, because I don't know where I'm going. And I don't know, I don't even know where it came from. I cover my eyes, and I say, Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad. But not Hashem, saying Hashem's name. And of course, the famous question that I get, if you're so secular, how do you know how to say Shema Yisrael? So the truth was that I was so secular. But the reality is, our sages teach us that when the baby is in the mother's womb for 9 months, stands an angel with the baby and teaches the baby the entire Torah. A second before the baby is ready to come out of the body, the angel tells the baby, come, let me take you on a tour. And he takes the baby on a tour and he tells him, here's the doctor that is about to deliver you. Here's your mom, here's your dad, here's your siblings, here's where you're going to grow up. And he takes him throughout his life. Here's your wife, here's your kids, here's your business. You're going to live here, this is what's going to happen here. Takes a whole tour from day one to the last day. And then he takes the baby to the last day of his life, to the cemetery. And he tells him, you see that plot over there? 17B? That's yours. That's where you're going to end up. Now go out. So the baby says, I don't want to go out. He says, no, you got to go out. The baby's like, Papi Tom, I'm not going out. The angel tells him, you got to go out. It's the time. No, I'm not going to go out. I don't want to go out. It's good here. So the angel pushes him out. Stands the Satan, the devil, right outside, hits him on his mouth, and makes him forget the entire Torah. That's why we have this little mark here on our lip from the hits that we got. And then we forget the entire Torah. We don't remember nothing. But about a second before the soul is ready to leave the body, you know who shows up? The angel. Hey, how are you? Remember me? We were roommates for 9 months. Remember? And in one shot, the baby remembers everything. It's not a baby anymore, but the person remembers everything. In one shot, everything comes back. So in one shot, everything was clear. I knew everything. I knew where I am, who I am, where I'm going. I knew every little thing. And I knew that I can't do tshuva anymore. Because to do tshuva, you have to do actions. And I knew that tefillin I can't put anymore. And I knew I cannot keep Shabbat anymore. But you know what I can do? I can say Shema Yisrael. That's a mitzvah from the Torah. A man has to say twice a day, Shema Yisrael. It's a mitzvah from the Torah. Besides the fact that when you say Shema Yisrael, the basic explanation is, I give up. You're the boss. There's nobody but you. Echad. Hashem Echad. So I cover my eyes and I say Shema Yisrael Hashem Enokeinu Hashem Echad. And the second that I say the pasuk, I fall down on the girl that's sitting next to me. And it was in a cab in New York. So you know the cabs have this partition between the front and the back. I'm lying on the girl and I see this partition and I feel I'm leaving my body through my eyes, diving out of my eyes, like you dive into a pool, head first. I'm leaving my body, I'm diving out of my eyes, and I wake up in this weird place. I don't see anything, I don't feel anything. All I notice is that there's no sound. Complete silence. Unbelievable silence. The most peaceful, calm, unbelievable feeling you can imagine. And you don't notice how much noise is around us all day long. If you're going to be quiet now for 20 seconds, well, here's a lot of noise. But you hear all the engine from the air conditioning, you hear cars from outside, you hear a motorbike from far away. Even if it's 2 o'clock in the morning and you're in the middle of nowhere in the mountains and all the windows are shut, you still hear some type of a buzz in your ear. There's always sounds around us, and we don't notice how much it's bothering us. turn the sounds off for 5 seconds. Quiet. This was the most amazing silence you can imagine. Mute, dead, no sound. The next thing that I feel, that I have no body. I'm a cloud. I'm air. I'm there, I'm here, I'm there, I'm there, I'm everywhere. And that's another thing we don't even notice, how much our body is limiting us. We don't even notice that. Everywhere you go, you have to carry a sack of bones. I want to go over there, I have to carry with me 200 pounds. I'm like a turtle. We don't even notice that. We're like turtles, we're carrying something with us. We just, you know, it's our body, so we feel it's part of us. But it's not. We're a spirit dressed in a body. And we don't even notice how limiting our body is. I want to lift up my hand. Look at this, 40 pounds, just like that. Everything that I got to do, I got to move myself. And I'm feeling that I'm like a cloud. I'm everywhere. I'm floating, weightless. And the third thing that I feel is that there's no time. I don't have a watch on my hand. I don't have to go anywhere. I don't have to be anywhere. And this is another thing that you don't notice, that our entire life is defined by time. Seconds, minutes, hours, days, a month. Look at your day. You wake up in the morning at 7. I have an appointment at 8. I have a doctor's appointment at 12. I have a class at 1. I have to do this at 4. My entire life is like boxed in time. And even if you go on a vacation and you think that you're not bound to time, no, I still have to have breakfast, and then I have lunch, and then I have a movie, and then I have a trip, and then I have this. And the time always running. You can't stop the time for 1 second. So I'm flying in this place of nothing, no body, no sounds, and no time, like this perfect vacation. Now, as all this is happening, which I don't know if it's a second or 2 hours or 1,000 years, I was still having my thoughts. The me was still me. And the thing is that every person has thoughts. Every human being has thoughts that are running in his mind 24/7. Even when you're asleep, your thoughts are running in your mind. Even when you're busy and you're not concentrating, your thoughts are still running in your mind. The Midrash compares our thoughts to a river. The same way that a river constantly flows, that our thoughts are running in our mind 24/7, that they don't stop. Now, if you're busy working, doing things, then you don't concentrate on your thoughts. But if you're by yourself, in the shower, in bed, in traffic, your thoughts are running in your mind. And you have conversations with yourself. Now, if you're American, you think in English. If you're Israeli, you think in Hebrew, whatever language you grew up with, whatever is your mother tongue, that's the language in your mind. And you have conversations with yourself. And you tell yourself some jokes, and sometimes you tell yourself Lashon Hara. Sometimes you add another person to the argument, and there's a whole argument going on in your mind. Sometimes you tell yourself jokes. But constantly you're talking to yourself. So you have your own thoughts. So I was having my own thoughts, and I was saying to myself, what's going on here? Where am I? How did I get here? What is this place? So this voice is telling me, you're dead. This is your death. You just died. And I'm like, what? That's how I die? The voice is telling me, yeah, you're dead. And it's kind of pointing down. Now, there wasn't a hand. There wasn't eyes to see the hand. I kind of understood, like a dream, like in a dream, there's no visions in a dream. You kind of thinking of it. I understood that this voice is telling me to look down. So I look down like this, and I see my body on the girl in the cab from the height of, like, as if I'm stuck here to the ceiling. And I look down and I see everything from above. And this voice is telling me, you died. This is your death. And I'm like, what? That's how the story ends? Just like that? That's the movie of my life? Yeah. And in my mind, I'm thinking like, what? That's how my friends are going to remember me? What, my friends are going to meet? Hey, remember Alon? Yeah, I remember him. Oh, he dropped dead in the back seat of a car. It was the weirdest thought that that's how I end my life. Because the truth is, nobody really thinks of their death. Nobody sits at home and says, I wonder how I'm going to die. Nobody planning their death. Nobody sits at home and says, oh, I want a car accident, please, please. You don't think of your death. And if you're already thinking of your death, you're saying, at least let me die when I'm 90 years old, with like 100 grandkids, and after I achieved all my dreams. And if I chas v'shalom have to die young, then at least give me a good death. Let me jump out of a plane and the parachute is not going to open. Something with action. What is this? It was the weirdest thought that that's how I die. But amazingly, there was no pain. No sorrow, no nothing. I'm hovering over the body, I'm looking down, I see the whole thing. It's like looking at a movie and the hero died. That's it. And the car is driving in Manhattan. And I'm over the car. Wherever the car is going, I'm going. Like a camera, looking what's going on from above. And I feel like something is pulling me up. But very, very slow. Very, very subtle. And the higher I go, the more I see from below. And then happens this weird thing that I felt that I dived into this girl's body that my body is on. And I dive into her body, and within a split second, I see her entire life. From the moment she was born till that day, I'm scanning her life. And it's not that I'm sitting like this and looking at a screen and I see her life. I'm in her body. So whatever she's thinking, I'm thinking. Whatever she sees, I see. She's happy, I'm happy. She's in pain, I'm in pain. And I don't see it like a movie, like going in the sequence of her life, like baby 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Thousands of scenes with no connection to each other, simultaneously. And no order in the timeline. And as this is going, I see what's going on in the present. I hear her thoughts. I see what's going on. I feel her anxiety, how she's freaking out. And then I see a little step into the future. And I see her, they're telling my parents in Israel, on the other side of the world, that I died. And I see my parents crying, and I see my sisters crying, and I see like a little step into the future. Now, a lot of people tell me, listen, I can somehow relate with the fact that you were hovering over the body and saw what's going on. But how can you see the past of the girl, the present, what's going on, and into the future? I mean, it doesn't make sense. So the short explanation of this is that while our soul is in our body, the soul is very limited to the body. So the body is very limited. It can only see from here to the end of the street. And my body can only carry a certain amount of weight. And I'm only going to hear to a certain distance. And I can only live in the present. I cannot see the past. I can go back to the past. I cannot go into the future. I'm only living the moment. But that's only because my soul is in a body and the body is very limited. But the second that the soul leaves the body, it's not limited anymore. The soul can stand here and see the other side of the world. The soul can be present and hear 50,000 conversations at the same time with no problem. And the soul can see the past, the present, the future. The soul can go anywhere she wants. So I was able to see this girl's past, this girl's present, what's going on in the future, all at the same time. Now, as all this is happening, the car is driving in Manhattan, I'm being like floating up and up and up and I'm going higher and higher. At some point, I'm like the height of like maybe 2 or 3 floors. And the car went under this little overpass. If you know Manhattan a little bit, about 11th Avenue and 17th Street next to the car wash, there's a very low bridge, an old subway bridge. The car goes under this overpass, and I was so high, I went in the bridge. And I suddenly see, I like calling it the graphic design of the world. And I'll tell you what I mean. Imagine now you're looking on a website, and you see a beautiful website, beautiful colors, beautiful pictures. You click a button, opens a page, click another button, starts playing a video. What would you see if, hypothetically, you would remove the screen? What would you see? You would see the code that creates the website. Now, if you're a programmer, you know what, you understand what you see. Now, if you're not a programmer, all you see is a bunch of letters and symbols and nothing makes sense. So if you're looking at it, it doesn't make sense. A programmer could look at the code and understand what this line is going to do. And this line is going to make that color. And this line is going to make this work. But how does it really work? A guy sits down, writes a code with an unknown language, clicks a button, ta-da! Beautiful website. The exact same way, that's how God creates the world. Our sages teach us ba'asara ma'amarot nivra ha'olam. With 10 speeches, the world was created. God talks and he creates the world. Now God doesn't have a mouth. It's just for us to kind of relate with the concept. But we know that God has many different powers. One of the powers is the power of speech. So God creates the world with talking. And we see it quoted in many different verses, but whoever from you will praise every day in the morning shacharit, we say every morning, Baruch she'amar, v'haya olam, blessed he that he said, and the world was created. Now how does he do it? The Kadosh Baruch Hu takes 22 sophisticated tools, which are the letters of the Lashon Kodesh, of the holy language of Hebrew, puts them together like a code, like a programmer. Ta-da! Beautiful world. Now a lot of people think that HaKadosh Baruch Hu created the world and then went out for lunch. The reality is that Hashem recreates the world every second. And if Chas V'Shalom, Hashem moves out, there's no world. Everything goes back to where it came from. And we see that also when we pray every day in the morning. It says, "Uvotuvo mechadesh b'chol yom tamid ma'aseh bereshit." Every second he recreates the world. And how does he do it? Hashem injects a certain power into the world, a certain energy. The Ari HaKadosh calls it Nefesh, Nefesh Chaya. And everything in this world has this godly energy that enlivens it. Everything has it. Animals have it, human beings have it, trees, inanimates, everything, this table, everything has a godly power that enlivens it. We just don't see it. But the reality is that if you would remove this screen that creates a filter to the physical world, you would see this godly energy that enlivens everything. And the second that I went into this bridge, everywhere that I looked, all I see is millions and millions of letters. Everywhere I look, I just see letters running everywhere. Millions of letters. And I'm reading the letters, I'm reading the code, and I understand what I see. Now, not because I'm Israeli and I know Hebrew, because all the souls know only one language. There's only Lashon Kodesh in Shamayim. There's no languages up there. You don't go up to Shamayim with Google Translate. And all the souls know it. So I'm reading the code and I understand what I see exactly like a programmer that doesn't see the end product, just the code. And I'm reading the code and I understand every little thing, and I'm looking at every letter, and every letter is built from endless amount of more letters. And every letter in there is more letters. Maybe some of you are familiar that we know that each letter has a numerical value. Aleph is 1, Bet is 2. But Aleph can also be read as Aleph Lamed Pei. So now the numerical value changed completely. And then there's what's called Tzerufei Otiyot, that you combine letters. Then there's Chilufei Otiyot, that you switch letters. There's all these Gimatriot. I see how every letter is built from Ensof, from more letters. And each letter is one power, how God creates the world. And it literally felt like I'm there 50,000 years of endless information. And just on this topic, I can sit here another hour and just describe every little thing. But since I want to kind of zoom through it, we're going to go through the end. Then later on, you can ask me whatever you want. The amazing thing was that how long does it take a car to go under an overpass? Maybe a second and a half. And it literally felt like I'm there for thousands of years. And the car is driving in the streets of Manhattan, and I'm being pulled up and up and up and higher. And at some point, I'm the height of like maybe 30 floors. You know, I was like flying over the city of Manhattan like a bird. You know, people pay thousands of dollars to fly over Manhattan. I did it for free. So the same way how I dived into this girl's body, I feel like the buildings don't have walls. And I'm going through the buildings, like I'm scanning the buildings. And the same way that I see this girl's body and her life, I see thousands of people in these buildings. Thousands. Imagine now you're standing in front of a building in Manhattan, 30 floors. All you see is like a wall with a lot of boxes, all the windows. Now imagine that hypothetically you would remove the wall. You would see in the apartments. You know, like these Barbie, like these little dollhouses that you look on the front side. It's like a house. Then you turn it around and you see all the rooms. Kind of like that. And there's no walls. There's no physicality. So I'm going through the buildings and instantly I'm seeing thousands of people and I see in every apartment what's going on. And not only did I see what's going on, every human being that I see, I'm reading their mind. I'm scanning their entire life. I see everything about them. Like as if I'm now in this room sitting and I know all of you at the same time what's going on in your mind. And not only what's going on in your mind, every little detail about you. Where you were born, what's your birthday, what's your mother's name, what's your favorite food, what you had for lunch. Every little detail about every person, like as if I'm going one by one, scanning them from bottom to top, one by one. Simultaneously, hundreds and hundreds of people. I always stop to say a funny story. That when I went to my first date with my wife, I told her this story. Now, I was like 70% religious. She was like 17.5% religious. The rabbi thought it's going to be a good match, puts us together, and we're sitting in a coffee shop, and she tells me, listen, I heard you have this crazy story, how you became religious. So I told her, you want to hear it? I'll tell you. Just that tonight, you're getting the short version. She got the long version. It was a 9-hour date. And a lot of coffees. Now, the next day after the date, she told me later, but she told me that the next day after the date, she threw all her pants away. Now, not that she went cuckoo and started going naked in the street. That's what people think. She changed her wardrobe from pants to skirts. Now, why did I tell you that she was 17.5% religious? Because she grew up here in America, very, very secular. And when she went to college, she met a rabbi on the campus who invited her to a Shabbat meal. Then he invited her to a Pesach party and to a class. And slowly, slowly, he started to bring her closer. And 10 years later, she's sitting in a date in front of me. And she told me, listen, for 10 years, I'm bouncing backwards and forth with this whole religious thing. Now, I believed that there's a God. I believed that there's a creator to the world. And I believed that the Torah is real. And I believed that I have a soul and there's an afterlife. I believed all these things. I knew it. There was only one question that nobody was able to answer me. And that stopped me from becoming observant. And you were able to answer this question. And you know when you answer this question from the 9-hour date? The part with the building. That was the part that nailed it. And you know what was my question? She tells me, my question was, how can it be that there are about 7 billion people in the world and trillions of animals and creatures? And you want to tell me that God knows me? Can't be. He can't know so many people. So you know what? Let's ignore now all the people in the world. Let's just concentrate on the Jews. Let's just concentrate on the religious Jews. So you want to tell me that on Yom Kippur, 3 million people, give or take, are all in a shul praying and God can hear 3 million people? No. Can't be. Can't be. He cannot hear 3 million people. I understand he knows the famous ones. But me? Why would he know me? Now, if he doesn't know me, so why should I bother? Why should I be dressed modest? What, he's looking at me? Why should I say a blessing when I put something in my mouth? Does he really care that I say a blessing or not? Why should I do all these things? So I'll be a good person, and I'm not going to steal or lie. And that's it, and leave me alone. But she told me, when you told me that you were able to see in these buildings hundreds of people, know what they're thinking, know how they're feeling, and know everything in their, about their life, you made me realize how so much more so the master of the universe, the creator of the world, knows every little detail in this world. To a point that a little ant, a fly, doesn't fly across the room without the Kadosh Baruch Hu knows where that fly is and gives the permission for that fly to move. Nothing moves in this world without the permission of the Kadosh Baruch Hu. To a point even the Arizal says a leaf doesn't even turn over without an angel standing next to the leaf and tells the leaf, turn over. And an angel above that and an angel above that. Millions and millions of angels are running the system, and the Kadosh Baruch Hu, like a sophisticated computer, is controlling trillions of details every second. And that's just things around the world. So much more so a human being, and alachat kama vekama, so much more so a Jew, that for one second in his life stops his day and says, Shakol niya midvaro. You know what happens in Shamayim the second you do that? What? Kadosh Baruch Hu stops his business. What? I can't believe it. He said a blessing. He remembered me. A party in Shamayim. 4th of July, fireworks. He said a blessing. He stopped his day. That's what's going on in Shamayim when you stop for 5 seconds to say a blessing. The master of the universe stops his business to listen to your little blessing. So much more so when you do much more than that. The Kadosh Baruch Hu is next to you 24 hours a day. He doesn't move away from you. You're happy, he's happy with you. You're sad, he's crying with you. You're worried, he doesn't understand why. You do something good, he has full of joy. You do something bad, he's upset. He's next to you. Like as if the world was created just for you. Like as if there's nothing else but you and the Kadosh Baruch Hu. And my wife told me, that made me realize, wait a minute, I gotta cover myself, this is embarrassing. He's looking at me. And now I can actually say a blessing when I put something in my mouth. He cares. I can actually pray. And Baruch Hashem, the next day she threw her pants away. And you know what's the funniest part of this story? That 2 weeks later when I asked her to marry me, she agreed. Up until today she's like, what did I do? Every day this guy disappears, comes home at 3 o'clock in the morning. No, she's happy. From the fact that I come home at 3 o'clock in the morning. No, she's smart. She has 50% of the deal. So Baruch Hashem, up until this point, what I told you now up until this point is really not even a fraction of what I really saw. What I saw, even words cannot even describe. I mean, the biggest producer in Hollywood cannot come up with ideas with what I saw. But up until this point, everything was good. Everything was amazing. Everything was unbelievable. But within a split second, I feel like something grabs me from behind. And instantly, I'm in this pitch black place. I wake up in this black place. I don't see anything. All I feel is that something is holding me so strong. It literally felt like 100,000 pounds on me, squashing me. Unbelievable pain. It's not a physical pain that I can say, oh, it hurt like a root canal. The spiritual pain of pressure, this unbelievable pressure. And the darkness was so thick, it was literally scary. I know it sounds like childish, you know, afraid of the dark, but it was the most scariest darkness you can imagine. You can't even imagine how scary it is. Now, worse than this, first of all, I don't know where I am. More than that, I don't know how I got there. And more worse than that is I don't even know how I'm getting out of there. I'm stuck in this void of darkness, unbelievable pain, and I don't even know if I'm ever getting out of there. Now, it feels like the thing that is holding me is pulling me up through a funnel. And the entire walls of the funnel are full of blades. And the more it's pulling me up, it's like ripping pieces out of my neshama. Unbelievable pain. And I'm screaming from pain, and I hear my own screaming, unbelievable, like this horrible noise. And it feels like I'm there, not exaggerating, for thousands of years. Thousands of years of this unbelievable torture. Now, I really want to zoom through the story, because just describing this 2,000 years of torture, that's another 5 hours. But we'll get to that later. The point is that at some point it felt, I'm not exaggerating, like I'm there for thousands of years. Thousands of years of this unbelievable torture and pain and suffering. And it literally felt like I'm being choked. Like something is choking me. I'm being suffocated. Now we don't even notice that, that's the most desired and needed thing in our life we have for free, and we don't even notice that we're consuming it. You're taking breaths of air every 2 seconds. Take your air for 5 seconds, you choke. And we don't even notice how the most basic thing in our life is free, and I don't even concentrate on the fact that I'm taking it all the time. But just try to hold your breath for 10 seconds. You choke. You ever saw a person choking? My son, not too long ago, had a big piece of meat, started suffocating on the meat, choking. Our table, Baruch Hashem, is very long. It took me a couple seconds to run from one side to the other side. The few seconds, looking in his eyes, the fear of being, of choke, of, I'm helpless. It literally felt I'm being choked spiritually, that I can't breathe. Now, what's the result of being choked? Death. Now, the thing is that at some point, I kind of realized what's going on. I realized where I am. I realized what's holding me. I realized where I'm going, and I knew I'm going to the worst place in the universe. And the reason why I realized all that is from a very simple reason. Because, not to compare the world above, in this world, there are two types of realities. The first reality is called truth. But the other reality in this world is called a lie. And a person can create a lie in this world and nobody will ever know. You can come up with a story, invent some story, and as long as you don't tell it to anybody, nobody knows. And that's the reality. But it only works in this world. In the world above, there's no such a thing. In the world above, there's only one reality. And that reality is called truth. Emet. You can't bend the truth. You can't tell a lie, a little white lie. It's exactly 100% as it is. Emet. Truth. And you can't distort it. And you can't make up anything. The truth is exactly how it is. Here in this world, you can bend the corners a little bit. But don't get used to it, because in Shamayim, there's no such a thing. The truth is exactly how it is. Deal with it. So I knew exactly where I am, where I'm going, who is holding me. I knew everything. And I knew that I'm going to the worst place in the universe. And I realized that this feeling of being suffocated is the result from one simple thing. Is that I don't have one little connection to the Master of the Universe. Now in Shamayim, there's nothing but the Kadosh Baruch Hu. Nothing else can stand for you. No lawyers, no money, no friends, no nothing. En od milvado. There's nothing but the Kadosh Baruch Hu. And I realize that this feeling is only because I don't have a connection to Him. Now Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai explains in the Zohar that from the soul to the Kadosh Baruch Hu, there's a rope that connects the neshama to the Kadosh Baruch Hu. And the same way that a physical rope is built from many, many thin strings, then the spiritual rope is built from 620 strings, corresponding to the 613 mitzvot that we have in the Torah and 7 mitzvot that our sages gave us. Now, if a person is a God-fearing person, then all 620 strings are connected. Very good. The Zohar calls it 620 pillars of light. Now, go and do one sin. So you cut one string. And then you do another sin, you cut another string. And then you do another sin, and you cut another one. And then you don't do a positive mitzvah, so you cut another one. And then you start cutting them. So cutting 20, 30, 40, 50 out of 620, it's not that bad. But then you're cutting them more and more and more and more. And at some point, there's nothing barely left from this rope. The problem is that some acts that you can do in this world, one act cuts the entire rope. One act. There are 36 acts that a person can do. Two are positive acts, 34 are negative acts. that cuts the entire rope. A person who eat a crumb this big of chametz on Pesach, ונחרטה הנפש ההיא, the whole rope gets cut off. One little crumb like this. A person eats on Yom Kippur, drives on Yom Kippur, works on Yom Kippur, ונחרטה הנפש ההיא. One little act, a little drop of water. A person desecrates Shabbat, נחרטה הנפש ההיא. Half of these acts has nothing to do with us. Has to do with the sacrifices in the Beit HaMikdash and sorcery. But half of them are relating to us. Shabbat, Pesach, Yom Kippur, all the forbidden relations that the Torah prohibits us. Circumcision. One act and a person cuts the entire rope. Now, in the spiritual realm, everything is built through a concept that is called the Ten Sefirot. 10 godly powers that they go in a chain reaction, in a chain level, one after the other. The highest sefirah is called Keter. Keter is a crown. When a person, chas v'shalom, goes on one of these averot of karet, and the whole rope gets cut off, it cuts off the first 9 sefirot. But the last sefirah, the top one, the sefirah of Keter, doesn't get cut off. That's because Avraham Avinu made a deal with the Kadosh Baruch Hu, and he says, you cut the entire rope, but you leave me one, so the Jew can do tshuva. And amazingly, you see that the exact same letters of karet are the exact same letters of keter. When a person, chas v'shalom, does an avera of karet, yeah, he cuts off all 9 sefirot. There's no connection. A little spark is left. But from the highest sefirah, to reach to keter, to do tshuva, it's possible. Everything is possible. A person can do tshuva from the worst place that you can imagine. The problem is that a person can do an act in this world and he doesn't feel anything. Nothing. Good or bad. You know, not too long ago came this guy to my Shabbat table and we're having an argument. And he's telling me, where does it say in the Torah I can't turn off the light? Show me in the Torah that I cannot turn off the light on Shabbat. Show me that and I'm going to stop turning on and off the light. And to annoy me, he goes to the wall and he starts turning the light on and off. On, off, on, off, on, off. And he tells me, see? Nothing's happening. Told him he must be suffering from some type of rare disease of stupidity. I told him, let me explain to you what's happening right now. I told him there's a story. They took once two soldiers and they put them in a bunker 500 feet under the ground, and they told these two soldiers, you see this red button? Don't press it. If you press that red button, the nuclear missiles go off. Don't press this button till we give you an order. Okay? So they're sitting in the bunker. A day passes, 3 days pass, a week pass, a month pass. They're like bored out of their mind. So one soldier tells his friend, hey, let's press the button. Let's see what happens. So he tells him, what, are you out of your mind? They told us not to. They gave us an order. I know orders, schmorders, who cares? Let's press the button. Let's see what happens. He says, are you out of your mind? They told us that if we press the button, the nuclear missiles are going off. I know, you believe them. You really believe them? Nonsense. Let's press the button. So he convinces him to press the button. So he presses the button. Quiet. He tells him, you see? Nothing happened. They lied to us. Let's press the other one. They press the other one. Shh. Don't quiet. And they start pressing the buttons. Now they don't notice. They're 500 feet under the ground. They're in the bunker. They don't notice that missiles are flying all over the world and destroying half of the world. But they're in the bunker. They don't hear nothing. So I told this guy, I told him, you are in a bunker. You don't notice now that with a press of a button, nuclear missiles, so to say, in the spiritual world are destroying worlds in the world above. And every press, you're launching a nuclear missile in the spiritual world. The fact that you don't feel it, it doesn't mean that it doesn't happen. That's the point, is that we do certain acts and we don't see the results. People think that you have to see a result right away. Oh, I'll see a result, I'll do it. I mean, people think that they're going to put tefillin on and they're going to start seeing Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. That doesn't work like that. Not too long ago, a young lady came to our Shabbat meal and my wife told her, "You want to light candles?" So she know, you know what she tells my wife? "Oh, you want to make it romantic?" My wife tells her, "No, we light candles on Erev Shabbat. It's a mitzvah." Okay, so I see the girl lighting the candle, and then I see her looking at the ceiling. So I'm also looking at the ceiling, and I'm like, "What's going on? Is there a leak? What are you looking at the ceiling at?" She's like, "I'm waiting for something to happen." So what do you mean you're waiting for something to happen? She told me, "Your wife just told me that when I light candles, I bring a godly light into the world, and God comes into the world, and all these things happen. I'm waiting for something to happen." Are you serious? For 30 years, you live your life how you live your life, you think now you're going to strike a match and that's it? What do you think is going to happen? You think a check is going to fall out of the ceiling? What are you waiting for? The reality is that people think that they have to get right away a reaction from a certain act that they did. Yeah, after 30 years of doing it, you'll start getting reactions. You can't live your life and then one time do a mitzvah and you think that that's it, right away. Nachal av ruach Hashem. It doesn't work like that. Now, it works for both good and bad. I mean, you can do a mitzvah, you don't necessarily feel right away what's happening. If you would see with your eyes what happens to you when you put tefillin on, you would faint just from seeing what's happening that moment to your neshama. If you would see physically with your eyes what happens when you do a mitzvah or do a sin, you would faint on the spot. So the point is that we live in a bunker and we don't notice what's going on. So the Torah comes and tells us, don't do this. There's going to be an explosion. Don't do that. There's going to be a problem. Do this. This is good. So unfortunately, the way I lived my life is I lived my life in a way that the entire rope was totally cut off. That's why this feeling that I felt was this unbelievable suffocation. No connection to the Kadosh Baruch Hu. The Kadosh Baruch Hu is the source of life. There's nothing else in Shamayim but the Kadosh Baruch Hu. And if you don't have a connection to the Master of the Universe, you choke. You suffocate. You exist, but in unbelievable suffering. Like a fish that they pull it out of the water. Give it 2-3 seconds and it dies. It has to be in the water. So I realized that this suffering is because I don't have a connection to the Kadosh Baruch Hu. And I started screaming to Hashem, "Help me. Get me out of this. I'll do whatever you want. Whatever you tell me to do, I'll do. I'll be the best Jew in history. You want a beard? It's going to be till the floor. Whatever you want. I'll go with a black jacket. There's black jacket in 40 degrees outside. Whatever you want, I'll do." I'm not exaggerating. It felt like I'm there for 2 billion years of nothing. Of unbelievable suffering in this pitch black place. At some point after millions and millions of years, and I'm not exaggerating, I'm just saying millions and millions so you understand how long it looked, I suddenly see a dot of light. A microscopic dot of light. Now it sounds like a cliche, but it was the light at the end of the tunnel. Can you imagine seeing a little bit of light after a billion years of darkness? And I know that if I somehow get to this light, then I'll be saved. And I'm screaming to the Kadosh Baruch Hu, "Help me, I'll do whatever you want, I'll be the best Jew in history." And this light is coming closer to me, and closer to me, and closer to me. At some point, everywhere that I looked was this light. Mazal Hashem. So I see this light coming closer to me, and closer to me. And everywhere that I look, I see this light. This bright, bright light, white light. And I know that behind this light, with no doubts, is the Master of the Universe. There wasn't an if or maybe. I know that behind this bright screen of light is the Master of the Universe. And when I look into this light, I see a shape of a triangle. And it literally felt like as if a hand reached out from this light, grabbed me, and sucked me into this light. And I only found one way to describe how it felt. Besides unbelievable pleasure, I only found one way to kind of describe how it felt. Imagine now you take this little piece of metal. See? Now, if this piece of metal is not connected to the internet, then it's a very sophisticated camera. And it has a few games on it and a few other functions. That's it. Now take this little piece of metal and connect it to the internet. Any question you have, any topic you want to know, anything. All you do is you Google it, and within a split second, endless amount of information is in the tip of your hand. Now disconnect this device again back from the internet. It's back to being a sophisticated camera, and that's it. It literally felt like I got connected to some source of information, and instantly, all the wisdom of the universe was downloaded into me. Instantly, I was a genius. Anything you can just imagine was downloaded. And it felt like unbelievable pleasure. It literally felt like I'm being electrified from pleasure. Like I'm standing and being electrified from this unbelievable information that is not stopping to come. All the secrets of the universe was just given to me. Now, it has nothing to do with this world. Looking back at this world looked like a prehistoric planet. Like two little kids playing with Lego, putting a block on, above a block, and they get excited because they did a building with four blocks. That's how this world looked like. Like we look at our technology and we get all excited because... The souls look down at this world and they're like... We look like dinosaurs to the souls. The knowledge was not anything to do with this world. It was this divine, godly information. All the secrets of the world. Everything made sense. Now this information didn't come out one way. It came like in two channels. The first channel was that instantly I was a genius. Unbelievable genius. I knew everything. But the second channel was much more interesting. It's like as if I saw a panoramic picture of the world from the world, the day the world was created till the last day. One long panoramic picture. Genius master plan. Everything in the world made sense.
What are the channels
like? Later on I'll write the question, I'll answer later. But the panoramic picture was this beautiful picture from the entire world, from the day it was created till the end. One long panoramic picture. Genius master plan. Everything that doesn't make sense in the world made sense. Because everything that we looked in this world, nothing makes sense. You're looking in this world, what do you see? Death, diseases, terror attacks, wars, Holocaust, suffering, hardship. Any normal person will say, where's that God that you're talking about? That is supposed to be so nice, torturing us here? Yeah, but you're only seeing one piece of the puzzle. Looking in this world, it's like taking a 300-piece puzzle, spread all the pieces on the table, pick up one piece, now try to figure out the picture. You can't. Even if you have 30 pieces together, you'll never figure out the picture. So you look at this world, and you're holding two, three pieces of the puzzle, and you cannot figure out the picture. So you're looking at something like the Holocaust, it doesn't make sense to you. You're looking at a two-year-old kid dies, doesn't make sense to you. Your life doesn't make sense to you. Why do I have to suffer? Why is this not working out? Why is that not working out? You see one piece of the puzzle, nothing makes sense. And I saw this panoramic picture, this long, long, long picture. Everything made sense. Every detail was connected to another detail. Genius master plan. My mind was blowing away from pleasure, understanding the secrets behind the universe. And as all this is happening, I feel like I'm stuck into a bubble and I can't grab anything. I see it and I understand it, but I'm not part of it. I'm isolated. And as I'm feeling this unbelievable pleasure from seeing everything, I feel the complete opposite of unbelievable torture, that I have nothing to do with it, that I can't even grab it. And it's like as if they're telling me, you have nothing to do here, you gotta go. You can't stay here. And I'm like, no, 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 leave me here. You can't stay here. You have nothing to do here. And I feel like I'm being ripped out of this place, thrown into this huge room, I don't see anything, complete darkness. All I notice is I'm completely, completely naked. Completely naked. I'm standing in this room naked like this. But not naked from clothes. Naked from mitzvot. Our sages teach us that when you do a mitzvah, you sew a garment to your neshama, to your soul. You do another mitzvah, another garment. Another mitzvah, another garment. The same way, if you're looking at a garment in this world, look at the jacket, you have a sleeve and a puff here and the collar and another sleeve. Every mitzvah sews a piece of a garment that your soul gets dressed in when it goes up to the Shemaim. Now, if chas v'shalom, a person does a sin, then he puts a stain on the garment. Do another sin, another stain. Another sin, another stain. Small sin, small stain. Big sin, big stain. Many sins, many stains. Now, if the person is smart, comes Yom Kippur, he does tshuva, washes off half the stains. But Yom Kippur only works for a certain amount of averot. A lot of the sins that we do, Yom Kippur doesn't really help. But if a person is not smart, and he didn't do tshuva in this world, then he goes up to Shemayim with all these stains. Then you have to wash it up in the heavenly dry cleaner. That's not such a nice process, to wash off all these stains off the neshama. My problem was that I was completely naked. I didn't even have a mitzvah. I'm standing in this hole completely naked, and I look all around me, and all I see is millions and millions of eyes looking at me. Millions. All the souls of all the Jews of all generations are standing there looking at me. And all the souls are souls of tzedikim, of righteous people, and I'm the only wicked soul. And everybody's looking at me like, oh, it was you. And I'm so naked that I'm transparent, like a bottle. And they all see through me. Every thought that I ever had, they see it. Every word that came out of my mouth, they know it. Millions of souls, including all of you, are standing there and they see through me. I'm totally transparent. There's no words to describe the shame. Unbelievable shame. I don't know what to do with myself. That everybody knows everything that I ever did in my life. Just imagine the most darkest thoughts you have in your mind, that everybody knows it. And all the things that you do in closed rooms, everybody knows it. And looking at you, like, what? That's what you're thinking? I don't know what to do with myself. Worse than that, I feel like the Kadosh Baruch Hu is standing right in front of me. I feel like I'm standing with my head down. You know, when a person is embarrassed, he puts his head down. Now, there wasn't a head, but I felt like I'm with my head down. And I knew that if I lift up my head, I see the Kadosh Baruch Hu. I see the Master of the Universe. But I was so embarrassed, I couldn't even lift up my head. Now, I knew, I didn't think that I'm going to lift up my head and I'm going to find somebody standing with a baseball bat waiting to knock me down. I literally felt like I broke my father's heart. You know how it felt? It felt like the Kadosh Baruch Hu told me, what did you do? What did you do? I sent you down to this world with a list this long of things to do. And a list this long of things not to do. And everything I told you to do, you didn't do. And everything I told you not to do, you did. You messed it up. You didn't even get one. It literally felt like I broke Hashem's heart. I didn't know what to do with myself. I couldn't even lift up my head. And I knew they were about to take me to the next room. And I was begging them, please, please, leave me here. Don't take me there. Leave me here for eternity. Just don't take me there. Sure enough, they take me to the next room. Now, I don't see anything. It's like as if my eyes are covered. But I know I'm in a courtroom. And I know I'm about to be judged now for every little thing that I ever did. And I don't even know where I had the nerve. I look to my left, and I see like battalions, rows of angels, these scary, scary angels. For every sin that I ever did, stands an angel. There's a Mishnah that says that when a person does a sin, he creates himself a prosecutor that goes up to the heavenly court and says, he lied. He stole. But the same Mishnah says that if you do a good deed, a mitzvah, you create yourself a defense attorney. Goes up to the same court and says, well, relax, he's a good person. Look, he gave charity, he learned Torah, he did this. I don't even know where I had the chutzpah. I look to my right and I see two defense attorneys. One was crippled, the other one was blind. The third didn't want to show up that day. And they're telling me, you want to say something before we start? I'm like, what's to say? Did you see my two crippled attorneys? At this point, they're showing me the movie of my life. They're taking me back to this world, putting me back into my body in a very weird way because I'm in my body, but I see myself. And they're showing me my entire life from the moment I was born. And every little thing is pointed out. Here you stole, here you lied, here you cheated, here you pushed, here you cursed, here you did this, here you did that. And every person that I ever lied to is standing next to me. What? Why? And every person that I ever stole from is standing next to me. What? It was you? How dare you? Screaming at me. And millions of all the souls are standing there, looking at me like, you dared to lie? There's no words to describe the scene, the shame, that millions of souls are standing there seeing exactly what you did. Every person that you ever gossiped against is standing there. What? That's what you thought about me? Every person that you did something wrong is standing right there. Doesn't matter if they're alive or not. When you go to sleep at night, your neshama goes up to Shamayim to testify. Everybody's there. They're showing me a horror movie of 27 years. At some point, I'm like, cut it out! I got the point! They're coming and telling me, listen, Habibi, you're like a lost case. So they're trying to be real, real nice, and they're like, okay, let's see, maybe there's some good things. You must have some good things, no? They took all the good things and put it together. I'm like, okay, let's start reviewing. So when I was 8 days old, my parents circumcised me. Now, they didn't ask my permission. They still did it. So they're telling me, listen, it's not even your mitzvah, it's your father's mitzvah. So you were circumcised, we'll give you a mitzvah. And when I was 13 years old, my grandfather took me to Jerusalem, he put tefillin on me. So I'm like, okay, you put tefillin on, we'll give you a mitzvah. And one time a dollar fell out of my pocket and a hungry person picked it up, put something in his mouth. Like, okay, we'll give you charity for that one. And one time you helped that person, one time you smiled to that person, one time you did this, one time you did that. They put all the good things together. And they're telling me, listen, Habibi, you're a lost case. You have 99.9999999 bad and 0.0 nothing good. There's nothing to negotiate here. At this point, I thought, that's it. I'm going to be now on a skewer and on the way to the mangal. They're telling me, listen, you're really a lost case. But we're going to give you an option. We're going to give you two options. The first option is you go back to the black thing that brought you here. That Malach HaMavet, this angel of death that comes to rip the soul out of the body and to deliver it to the heavenly court, you go back to him. He's going to finish the job, which that wasn't really an option. Or you go back down to this world. But if you choose to go back down to this world, you have three conditions. The first condition is that you have to live your life like a Jew. Now, they're not telling me the definition of a Jew. They're not telling me Sfaradi, Ashkenazi, Breslev, Chabad, Jew. Because in Shamayim, all the Jews are the same. We're all the same. And to make sure that I understand what they mean by a Jew, they're showing me my entire life forward from that day all the way. And I see myself with this long beard. And then I see my wife. And then I see my wedding. And then I see all my kids, and I see my entire life forward, and they're telling me that's how you have to live your life. And don't come back here after 120 years and say, I didn't know. Nobody told me. You see? These are the rules. You can't bend the rules. You can't add rules. You can't remove rules. You can make up your own rules. These are the rules, and that's how you have to live your life. All the Jews are the same. The second condition is that you have 27 years of debt. So today is your lucky day. From 0 to 13, we giving you a coupon. You can erase everything. From 13 to 27, you have 14 years of debt. So you think to become religious is to put a yarmulke on your head and grow a 2-foot-long beard? No, no, no. You stole? Give it back. You insulted somebody? Go and apologize. You have a debt to fix. And the third condition is that you have to tell every person down there what you saw up here. You cannot go and live on a mountain in Alaska. Every person you have to tell what you saw up here. Now, I wasn't really in a position of telling them, you know what? Maybe give me a day or two to think about it. Maybe I'll consult my two attorneys. Maybe I get a better deal. I'm telling them, where am I signing? When are we starting? When's the next elevator going down? They're telling me, you gotta think about it good. Because you cannot come back here after 120 years and say, I didn't feel like it. It was too hard to wake up at 6 o'clock in the morning. It was too hot to go with a black suit in the summer. You're accepting the deal, that's the rules. It literally felt like I'm signing a deal. But there wasn't a contract. There wasn't a pen or a lawyer. It felt like I'm shaking my hands with the Kadosh Baruch Hu. And the second that I shake my hands with the Kadosh Baruch Hu, Hashem pushed me. I felt such an impact, like as if a train hit me. And I hear the Kadosh Baruch Hu telling me, "Ata chayav lachzor b'tshuva. You have to do tshuva." And the second that I feel this impact, the Kadosh Baruch Hu pushes me back into my body, and my eyes open up in this world. And I wake up in a hospital completely out of it. I don't notice what's going on. I see people above me talking to me. I don't hear anything. I don't know what's going on. I'm totally, totally out of it. All that's going on in my mind is that I have to do a mitzvah. That's what's going on in my mind. I have to do a mitzvah. I have to do a mitzvah. Now, at this point in my life, I had a friend that started becoming religious. And every day that he would see me, he would tell me, "You want to put tefillin on?" And I would tell him, "No." Every time he would see me, he was like, "Come put tefillin on." I'm like, "No." So I, in my mind, thinking how I have to do a mitzvah, so I call my friend, Itzik. Now it was Saturday morning. He wasn't that religious. He picks up the phone. So I tell him, "Itzik, I need you to come right now. I need to put tefillin on." He's like, "What?" I told him, "Itzik, don't ask any questions. Come now with your tefillin. I gotta put tefillin on." So he tells me, "You can't. It's Shabbat." I told him, "Who cares what day is it today? I need to put tefillin on." He's like, "Alon, what happened?" I told him, "Itzik, I told you the questions are at the end. Don't ask any questions. Just come with your tefillin on." So he tells me, "Alon, what happened to you?" I told him, "Itzik, just come. I have to put tefillin on." So he tells me, "But you can't. It's Shabbat." I told him, "But you're becoming technical. Shabbat, not Shabbat. Who cares? A whole year you're trying to put tefillin on me. Now's your chance." And he tells me, "Alon, makara, what happened?" I told him, "Itzik, I said the questions are at the end. Take me to a synagogue. I got to do something religious." So he tells me, "Why don't you come tonight? It's Pesach. Do Lel Seder." I said, "Oh, that sounds very religious. What are we going to do?" That night, he takes me here to Borough Park to my first Seder in history. I'm 27 years old and I never celebrated Pesach. He takes me to Borough Park to some Hasidic family. Needless to say that I'm shocked with what's going on there. But my first Pesach that I ever celebrated in my life. Now, 2 weeks passed from that day and I don't remember anything. I don't know what happened. I don't remember one detail. I knew something very weird happened because up until this day, I was a very rough guy. Every word that came out of my mouth was a curse. Somebody would look at me the wrong way, I would beat him up. Like, look at the picture, how I looked. I was like the wrong guy to mess with. Suddenly, I'm a nice guy. I go to work. "Hi, how are you?" So I knew something shifted. 2 weeks passed, I don't remember one thing. One night, I'm trying to fall asleep. I'm half asleep, half awake. Suddenly, everything that I told you, plus the 99% I didn't tell you, all wakes up in one shot. I wake up in the middle of the night freaking out. I see all these scenes in my mind. The first thing that I do, the girl that was with me in the cab is sleeping next to me. I wake her up in the middle of the night. Now remember in the beginning I told you that I dived into her body and I saw her entire life? I wake her up in the middle of the night and tell me, when you were 6 years old, did this and this ever happen to you? She was like, how do you know? And I told her, when you were 7, that happened to you? Yeah, how do you know? And when you were 8, you lived there and this happened to you? She was like, how do you know? Now I had a serious problem in my mind because I thought I lost it. I thought that I'm out. Because in my mind, I was like, this is not normal. But in my real mind, I was like, I'm under a deal. I gotta become religious. And I literally thought that I lost my mind. So I asked her another question and another question. Everything that I asked her, she was like, how do you know? Now I didn't want to tell her how do I know, because I was like, if I'm gonna tell her how do I know, she's gonna think I'm crazy. In fact, I was afraid to tell it to anyone. I was like, if I'm gonna tell any normal person what I just told you, you know what would be the reaction? Sit down. Relax. Put your hands in this white jacket. Take this pill. The doctor's coming any minute. Just relax. Everything will be okay. Now, I was afraid to go to the religious people. I didn't know what religious people think. I grew up seeing a group of people dressed the same, doing all sorts of weird things, swinging chickens over their heads, and I'm gonna go to them? They're crazy. I'm not the crazy one. So I didn't know what to do. So I call my friend Nitzik and I tell him, Nitzik, how do I become religious? What do I need to do? He tells me, there's a lot of things to do. I told him, okay, so give me the basics. So he tells me, okay, you gotta eat kosher. So I said, okay, what do we eat? He's like, it's not what you eat, it's what you don't eat. I said, okay, what don't we eat? He's like, well, you can't eat meat and dairy. I was like, that's it? No problem, I'll do it. He said, no, there's more. You can't eat all sorts of animals that you like. I was like, okay, so I'll go on a diet. No problem, that's it? He's like, no, there's more. I said, okay, what else do we need to do? He's like, you gotta pray. I said, okay, praying? Okay, that sounds like okay. Like, when do we do it? On Yom Kippur? He's like, no, every day. Every day? He's like, yeah, 3 times. 3? One is not enough? He's like, yeah. And then he tells me, you gotta put tefillin on. I said, okay, what are we looking at? He's like, you put it in the morning. I was like, how long does it take? He's like, yeah, 5 minutes. I said, okay. How much does it cost? He's like, $200. I said, okay, so give me 2. Then he tells me, you have to put tzitzit on. And then he tells me, you have to do this, you have to do that. I told him, it's it. I told you to give me the basics. You don't have to go into details. So I buy a tefillin. I buy a prayer book. I buy a tzitzit. I pack my bags and I leave New York and I move to Chicago. Where nobody knows me. No friends, no parties, no action, no nothing. Just me and the Kadosh Baruch Hu. Now, start becoming religious. How do you become religious when you're 27 years old? So I didn't mind the little things. I was like, I'll do the meat and dairy, and I'll put the tefillin on in the morning, no problem. But don't give me the big things. Don't tell me now, keep Shabbat, no more beach, no more dates, no more movies, no more this, no more that. I was like, no. I'll do the meat and dairy and the tefillin. So I would only look for easy things. So one time I open up the prayer book, and I see in microscopic letters this big, that when you leave the bathroom, you have to wash your hands with a funny looking cup, and then you have to say a blessing. I was like, okay, that sounds pretty easy. I'll do that. So I go and buy this funny looking cup with the handles, and every time I went out of the bathroom, I wash my hands, and I say a blessing, Asher Atzah. Now, I was convinced that I'm the tzaddik of the generation. I thought I'm a rebbe. I was like, nobody in the world washes their hands with a cup and says a bracha. I'm the most religious Jew in the world. One time, my friend Itzi comes to visit me, and he sees the cup, and he tells me, I see you doing Tilat Yadayim. I told him, Itzik, you know what I do You know what I do? Let me tell you what I do. Every time I go out of the bathroom, I wash my hands with this cup, and I say a blessing. So he tells me, that's nothing. You know what the real religious people do? They go to sleep and they put a bucket next to their bed, and they put this cup with water next to the bed, and when they wake up in the morning, they don't even put their feet on the ground and they wash their hands. I was like, what? What type of a lunatic will do that? So in my mind, I was like, these religious people, they're making these rules up. Doesn't even say in the Torah. So whatever didn't fit well in my mind, I was like, no, that's an invention. So I was only looking for little things. Now at some point, I knew I had to keep Shabbat. I mean, Shabbat is the famous one. Everybody knows Shabbat. So I was like, how am I going to do it? When I'm not going to work, I can't drive, I can't watch TV, no phone, no this. This is abnormal. So I was like, okay, next Shabbat, we'll start with the Shabbat. Friday would come, and I'd be like, no, not this Shabbat. Next Shabbat, we'll start. Friday would come, I would be like, no, I didn't mean this one. I meant the following one. And the next Shabbat would come, be like, no, today not so good. Next Shabbat, guarantee, we're starting. So I pushed the Shabbat like maybe 3-4 months. And then I came up with an idea. Now, at the time, I was a very heavy smoker. And when I was a soldier in the army, somebody approached me and he started to make fun of me, started doing his outreach. And he was telling me how I have a soul and how there's a Kadosh Baruch Hu and Hashem loves me and all these things. And he came with all these one-liners. And about an hour later, I told him, listen, Habibi, you're wasting my time. Leave me alone. I don't want to hear what you have to say. So he tells me, listen, I see that you're a very tough one. I'm just going to tell you one thing. You do with it whatever you want. So he tells me, on Shabbat, you're not allowed to light fire. And on Shabbat, you're not allowed to extinguish fire. So if you must smoke on Shabbat, then at least don't turn your cigarette out. So if you smoke 60 cigarettes a day, then you have 60 less sins. I told him, are you out of your mind? That's your religion. Tell me not to kill. Tell me not to steal. You're telling me not to turn a cigarette out? I thought he's completely crazy. 10 years later, when I had to keep Shabbat, I was like, wait a minute. I just found a loophole. I'm going to smoke. I'm going to finish my cigarette, put it in the ashtray. I keep Shabbat. So I would smoke, put the cigarette in the ashtray. I keep Shabbat. And if somebody would tell me, of course I keep Shabbat. Yeah, but I just saw you driving. Driving is fine. I don't turn out my cigarettes. And in my mind, I keep Shabbat. That's my Shabbat. For 3 months, ani shomer Shabbat, because I don't turn out cigarettes. And if I would turn out a cigarette by mistake, they're sharpening the skewer for me now in Geno. And for 3 months, I do not turn out cigarettes. And then somebody came and told me, listen, you can't watch TV on Shabbat. Every time you flip the channel, it's Chilul Shabbat. I said, no problem. I'm smarter than you. HBO, the whole Shabbat. I don't need to flip the channels. And in my mind, I keep Shabbat. I'm watching TV and I'm like, I'm so religious. I don't flip channels. And then a friend comes and tells me, listen, on Shabbat, you got to do Kiddush. So I said, Kiddush? What's Kiddush? He's like, you got to drink wine. Oh, now you're talking? So when a mitzvah came my way, I did it with all my heart. I used to drive 60 miles from where I lived to the north part of Chicago to buy kosher wine. And I used to get so excited. I walked into the supermarket. I thought I'm the most religious Jew in the world because I'm buying kosher food. And I got so excited. I bought a beautiful suit just for Shabbat. And a beautiful tablecloth just for Shabbat. And I would make a beautiful gourmet meal. I bought this beautiful fancy cup. I took the whole thing so serious. I got so excited. And then I would make the meal, do the kiddush, eat the meal, and then go watch a movie. So one time, my friend comes to visit me, and I tell him, it's Shabbat. We got to do kiddush. He's like, what? told him, just sit, say amen, and that's it. So we do the tablecloth, the fancy wine, the beautiful cup, the suit, the whole thing. And we eat the meal, and after that, we go out to a club. So, 4 o'clock in the morning, we're coming back from the club, and my friend tells me, listen, I hate to tell you that, but you're making a joke out of the whole thing. I told him, why are you saying that? He's like, because either you do Kiddush, and you keep Shabbat, and you stay home, but you can't do Kiddush and then go out to a club. It's kind of making a joke. Tell them, no, you're missing the point. So he tells me, okay, what is the point? I told him, go now to a playground. And now if you're going to see an 8-year-old boy jumping up and down the ladders and all doing all the tricks, nobody gets excited because all the 8-year-old boys do the same thing. But if you see now an 11-month-old baby take a step, guarantee within about 15 seconds there are 2,000 pictures on Facebook. Every step of this, he walked, he moved, I can't believe it. Why? Because he's a baby, and that's his first step. Told him, you know what happens right now in Shamayim when I do Kiddush? Let me tell you. The Kadosh Baruch Hu now calls all his angels. Come, 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 come. Look, look, look at my little boy. Look what he did. He drove 60 miles to buy kosher wine. I can't believe it. He could have bought the wine in the corner store by the guy. And look what he did. Look at that beautiful meal. And look at that suit. Did you see the cup? Look what he did. He stopped his life for 5 minutes to acknowledge that I exist, to thank me for creating the world. Who cares he went later to a club? It's a baby. He cannot do more than that. But look how much love went into the mitzvah. Look how much money went into the mitzvah. Look how much excitement went into the mitzvah. And I told my friend, I'm a baby. I'm going to keep Shabbat in a year or two. Now I can't. But if I'm already doing a mitzvah, I'm doing it with all my heart, with all my money, with all the excitement. I do it the perfect way. And in a few months, I'll do more mitzvot. Now I can't handle more than this. And I told him, yes, I'm not planning on staying here. I'm planning already to do the ultimate, but I have to take it in my steps. And that's how I lived my life for 2 years. 2 years every day I would add another thing and another thing and another thing. Miraculously, 2 years later, somehow I found myself back in New York, going through a very difficult time. And a friend of mine told me, listen, you know, I know you're going through a hard time. Why don't you come tonight? There's a party in Manhattan, in Esha Torah. It's a kosher party. Come, maybe you'll meet somebody. So he drags me along. I go to the party, Upper West Side to Esha Torah, big room, a whole party going on. And I really didn't feel like being there. Now, I felt very awkward just getting up and leaving. So I was sitting like that, putting on a fake smile, pretending like I'm enjoying myself. And then I moved like one seat, and then I moved another seat. And slowly, slowly, I made myself closer to the door. And when the time was right, I looked to the sides. Nobody was looking. I ran out. But my intelligence was very, very bad. Instead of running out of the building, I ran into the shul. So I come into the shul, stands a rabbi, long table, maybe 30 people around the table, and the rabbi tells me, come, 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 come. We're about to start the class. You didn't miss anything. And in my mind, I'm like, how am I getting out of that? And I'm like, no, no, it's very late. I gotta go home. And the rabbi tells me, come, come, come. You didn't miss anything. He puts me next to him, and in my mind, I'm like, great. Now I'm stuck with this guy. Now I never heard Torah in my life. This was my first Torah class in my life. The rabbi opens his mouth, and I was hypnotized. I could not move. I was like, I never heard Torah in my life. And I really had to be somewhere the next day in the morning, and I kept looking at the clock in the wall, and I'm like, I'm never going to get up, but I can't leave. Comes the end of the class, I walk up to the rabbi and I tell him, you must be some type of a rare genius. How do you know so many things? So he tells me, if you really enjoyed the class, why don't you come next Wednesday? There's another class. I told him, you didn't cover the whole Torah tonight? There's more? He's like, yeah. Sure enough, next Wednesday, I come to his class again. and the next Wednesday, and the next Wednesday. And then I became very friendly with the rabbi. So he tells me, listen, I see you really enjoy what I'm teaching. Why don't you come to my home every Thursday night from 12 a.m. to 6 a.m. All night we stay up and we study Zohar. And then we go to a mikveh. And then we pay shacharit and we get ready for Shabbat. Why don't you come and join us? I told him, you know what? That sounds like an amazing idea. I have nothing else to do between 12 a.m. to 6 a.m. every Thursday night. My calendar is totally free. Sure enough, I go to his home, sitting like maybe 10 men, and all night he's teaching Zohar. And all that he's talking about is souls and spirits and demons and spiritual worlds. And